Hello and welcome to Curator with a Camera. I'm Anthony Coulls, Senior Curator of Rail Transport and Technology, and we're here at Locomotion today to look at Sans Pareil, railway pioneer. So Sans Pareil is built in 1829, but the story begins a few years earlier than that, with this man here. He is the reason that Locomotion is here in Shildon. This is Timothy Hackworth. Now, Timothy Hackworth was a blacksmith from Wylam in Northumberland, and he learned his craft with his father, looking at steam engines, machinery in the pit, and he worked alongside other railway and engineering pioneers like George Stephenson and William Headley. But by the late 1820s, Timothy Hackworth is running the largest fleet of steam locomotives in the UK, and he's running them successfully on a railway line from Stockton to Darlington. The promoters of the Liverpool and Manchester Railway on the western side of England have decided they're going to build a line. But is it going to have locomotives? Is it going to have winding engines, as a lot of other early railways did? And so they come up with the idea of the Rainhill Trials, a competition to work out which form of locomotion is best to use on this new railway. Timothy Hackworth takes up the challenge and begins to build Sans Pareil, which translates as without equal. And this was to be Timothy Hackworth's finest hour, or so he hoped. This is the original Sans Pareil, built here in Shildon in 1829, or rather large parts of it were, as we'll talk about the engine through its story. It's big. You have to look up to it, and then your eyes get tired when you're looking even further to the top of the chimney, because this is built before anything such as a loading gauge within the UK comes in. So it's unfettered by size, but of course it is fettered by the rules of the Liverpool Manchester's Rainhill Trials. So it has to fit a weight limit. It has to be 4.5 tons. Other conditions from the Rainhill Trials were that the engine had to consume its own smoke, to be burn coke, which was very different to the coal, but also to have springs. Now, the springs they reckoned on this engine were so small, many people questioned whether they were there at all. It had steam cylinders connected directly to the wheels by a connecting rod and a coupling rod. It had the return flue boiler, which saw it increase the heating area available to use far more than the original locomotion with a single flue. And it had the steam, the exhaust steam, directed from the cylinders up the chimney through a blast pipe, where it encouraged further production of steam. But you'd stand back and look at this thing. What was it like to drive? What was it like to fire? It's like nothing on earth, because this is 1829. It's only 4 years after Locomotion, and it's less than 20 years after Headley and Stephenson and Hackworth are trying things out with Puffing Billy. It runs how we might see a conventional engine back to front, because the driver stands way up here on this platform. Please note, no safety harnesses, no guardrails, no handrails, but he's up here on this platform facing forward, and his controls are up there. There's a regulator, which currently isn't fitted, but then there are the valve handles there for operating the reversing gear. Go down to the eccentrics on the back axle here. So these are slip eccentrics, a gab valve gear, that you disengage them to set the engine going in the other direction. But that's the driver. Where's the fireman? The fireman's at the other end. So the fireman is perched in a coal tender here, which isn't there because it didn't survive, and he's firing the locomotive through this U-tube return flue boiler. So U-tube wasn't exactly always a film channel. It is a design of a steam engine boiler as well. And he's out in the elements. He has no cab. He has no protection. He's standing on this coal cart, and he's getting showered in cinders and ashes and hot coals coming out of this engine's chimney. As displayed here, the engine stands on an original section of Liverpool and Manchester railway track. Very different to the modern railway, the sleepers are stone blocks. And there you can see there's no tie between them, as you'd expect now. And the rail itself is what's called a fish belly rail. It's cast, and this is the longest section that you could make using the casting process at the time. So it's thin where these chairs carry the rail on the sleepers, but then it has this curved fish belly which takes the strength, that curve gives it the strength to operate, to run and carry a steam locomotive. It's really quite something. But let's talk a little bit about what happened in the Rainhill Trials. The three main runners, the three main contenders were Rocket of George and Robert Stephenson, Novelty of Braithwaite and Ericsson of London, and Sans Pareil. Hackworth thought he got the winning combination here. There was only time for this engine to be run on the line outside here, down to Hyington, midnight, just before the trials began, before it had to be taken by road to Liverpool. And these are where some of the disadvantages that Hackworth came to encounter during the trials set in. So the boiler and the cylinders, Hackworth couldn't make them here. He had to go to the Bedlington Ironworks. Now, the quality control at Bedlington wasn't always the greatest. And likewise, the road journey along bumpy roads to Rainhill wasn't exactly great either for a piece of what was then precision engineering. So by the time it got to Rainhill, unfortunately, there was a defect in the cylinders. And it was only under steam that this problem began to show itself. He had terrible trouble getting the boiler to keep water and maintain steam pressure. He was filling it with oats to try and make it seal, because that was a trick that was known in the stationary steam engine world. And by the time his engine was fit to run, he ran a number of trial trips as stipulated by the judges. And then this component here, the water pump, which fed water into the boiler to keep the water level up after steam production, the water pump failed and the engine became a no-go. Despite the fact it was a very, very close runner, Hackworth is unfortunately remembered because of the problems that beset him. But this isn't exactly the end of the story for Sans Pareil, because having persuaded the directors of Liverpool and Manchester and the judges that he could have another run, the engine did show that it had potential. Timothy Hackworth didn't win the £500 prize for the Rainhill Trials, but after the event, he was able to sell Sans Pareil to the Liverpool and Manchester Railway for £550. And in 1831, the Liverpool and Manchester Railway hired this machine to the Bolton and Lee Railway in Lancashire. After 10 years operation on the Bolton and Lee Railway, the locomotive found a further life. So recycling, upcycling, it's nothing new. This thing was not wasted. And it became a winding engine at Copple Colliery in Lancashire, until it's discovered by Benjamin Hick. Now, Benjamin Hick was an industrialist from Bolton, and he arranges to have it removed from that engine house, taken to his works, and restored to its locomotive appearance. So there is a new chimney fitted to it, for example. But you can tell that this is a restoration without the idea of making it run again, because of the wheel here and the pattern of wear on the tire of that wheel. That is not how a flanged wheel should be on a railway engine. That should be a taper that's straight across to the flange, as you can see there. But this is the pattern of wear that 10 years or more of stationary engine winding use puts into this wheel set. But of course, the guys who are rebuilding and restoring the engine don't realize that. So when they come to build a new wheel set for the locomotive, they copy what they've already seen. And so here we are again. There is another groove in this driving wheel of the locomotive. So in 1849, towards the end of his career, Timothy Hackworth has continued to innovate and build locomotives here in Shildon, and he builds a final finest work, his creation, and issues a challenge to Robert Stephenson. Let me pit my latest locomotive against your latest engine and we'll see who's best. And what did he call that engine? Sans Pareil the Second. Now the challenge of Sans Pareil the Second was never taken up by Stephenson. But I just wonder what would have happened if they had. Thank you for joining us today for Curator with a Camera, looking at the pride of Shildon, Sans Pareil. If you've enjoyed it, why not like, share, and subscribe so you don't miss out on other episodes of Curator with a Camera.